She's the one the spinsters recommend. Just name the kind of man your sister wants and she'll snatch him up. Don't forget to bring your maiden aunt and she'll match him up. Come on, Dolly. If your eldest daughter needs a friend.
Levi, born Gallagher, expert social introductions, ladies and gentlemen of excellent family, introduced under the most respectable conditions, in an atmosphere of elegance and refinement. Object, matrimony. Unfortunately, I won't be able to offer my usual lightning services today, as I have a previous appointment in Yonkers, New York, arranging the second marriage of Mr. Horace Vandergelder, the well-known half-a-millionaire. My late husband, Ephraim Levi, always said that means he's got at least 60,000 cash, but don't worry, I'll work my hardest to have you carried across somebody's threshold before the week is out. Now, I should also mention I'm available for financial consultation, instruction in the guitar and mandolin, short-distance hauling, and, varicose veins reduced. Mr. Kemper, the artist. You know, I'm something of an artist myself. I do those silhouettes with the black paper and scissors. Here's one of Ada Rahan looking the other way. I have to do them like that because I'm no good at noses.
Mrs. Levi, the train for Yonkers leaves in 5 minutes, and if we don't get there on time...
But we will, Mr. Kemper. And not only will Mr. Vandergelder give you permission to marry his niece Ermengarde, but he will also dance at your wedding, and not alone either, because I happen to be engaged in finding him a suitable second wife himself. What he really wants is someone steady to clean the house. My husband Ephraim Levi always said marriage is a bribe to make a housekeeper think she's a householder.
I know all about it, Mrs. Levi. Half of New York says he's gonna propose to Mrs. Irene Malloy this very afternoon.
Which is exactly why I'm on my way to Yonkers, right? One stone or whatever I'll throw, I'll see. Let me see. Oh, look at that. It looks like I have no money to pay my train fare with. Only large bills, fives and sevens.
I know I have some loose change in here somewhere, Mrs. Levi. I just hope this isn't a wild goose chase or nothing.
Oh, speaking of poultry, I'm also available for fresh Jersey eggs, surgical corsets reboned, ears pierced, and pierced ears replugged.
Mrs. Levi!
Just name the kind of man you're seeing. Once and she'll snatch him up. Don't forget to bring your maiden aunt and she'll match him up. Come on, Dolly.
tell me, Mrs. Levi, what's in all this for you?
A living, Mr. Kemper. Some people paint, some sew. I meddle. I have always been a woman who arranges things for the pleasure and the profit it derives. I have always been a woman who arranges things like furniture and daffodils and lives. When a man with a timid tongue meets a girl with a diffident air, why should the tortured creatures beat around the bush when heaven knows Mother Nature always needs a little push? So I put my hand in here, I put my hand in there. And a girl over 6'3" loves a man who comes up to her ear. Surely it's obvious she'll never be seduced till some kind soul condescends to give her bow a little boost. So I put my hand in here, I put my hand in there. Men who just say to assist the Lord above, I have always been a woman who arranges things like luncheon parties, poker games, and love. My aplomb at cosmetic art turned a frump to a trump lady fair. She had a countenance a little bit like Scrooge, but oh, today you would swear the Lord himself applied the rouge. I put my hand in here. Hello, how are you? Beautiful scarf, beautiful. I'll borrow that later. Hi, nice to meet you. Hello, how are you? Beautiful sweater.
Thank you.
Beautiful. Twist a little, stir a little, him a little, her a little, shape a little, mold a little, some poor chap gets sold a little, when I use my fist a little, some young bride gets kissed a little, pressure with the thumbs, matrimony comes when I put my hand in there.
Mrs. Levi!
Mr. Kemper, don't worry. Get on the train, order us lunch, get us a window seat, and I'll meet you on board. Ephraim Levi, I'm going to get married again. I'm going to marry Horace Vandergelder for his money and send it out circulating among the people like rainwater, the way you taught me. And I want a sign from you sometime today that you approve. Oh, it won't be a marriage in the sense we had one, but I shall certainly make him happy. And I'm tired, Ephraim. Tired of living from hand to mouth, so I want that sign from
you. Mrs. Levi!
Sometime today. Mr. Kemper, don't worry, we'll get to Yonkers. You'll make the train, just leave everything to me. For when my little pinky wiggles, some young maiden gets the giggles. Then I make my knuckles active. My, he says she's so attractive. Then I use my index digit. Then the bride begins to fidget. Then I clench my palm. The preacher reads a psalm when I put my hand in there.
Thank you.
can I be expected to play Yonkers, my Yonkers, with all that bellowing in my ears?
I can't help it, Uncle. I love Ambrose Kemper.
And I say you're too young to be in love with anybody. Here, take this.
I'm not too young. Whoa. I'm not too young. I'm 17. And in another year, I'll be an old maid.
Well, I forbid it. Dare to be an old maid, Ermengarde, and I'll cut you off without a cent. And don't cry in front of the store.
I can't help it. I'm so unhappy.
Then by thunder, you go and weep for a while in New York, where it won't be noticed. Now go upstairs and start packing your trunks. And don't get any tears on that lock. It was just oiled. Cornelius! Barnaby! I did both. I'm going to New York to march in the 14th Street Association Parade. And when I come back, you're going to have a mistress.
But I'm too young, Mr. Vandergelder.
Not yours, hell and damnation. Mine. I'm getting married again. And in honor of that occasion, I've decided to promote you, Cornelius, to chief clerk.
And what am I now, Mr. Vandergelder?
You're an impertinent fool, that's what. And I'm promoting you from impertinent fool to chief clerk. Any more questions?
Yes.
What?
Does chief clerk get one evening off a week?
So that's the way you thank me for your promotion, is it? No, sir. You'll attend to the store as usual. Now get back to work! And don't forget to put the lid back on that sheep dip! Evenings off? Marrying artists? Foolishness. You know, 99% of this world are fools. And the rest of us are in great danger of contamination. Why, even I was young once. Which was foolish. And got married, which was foolish. And then I was poor, which was more foolish than anything else. Then my wife died, which was foolish of her. And then I grew older, which was sensible of me, and became rich, friendless, and mean, which in Yonkers is about as far as you can go. Well, I know what you're wondering now. Why a man of so much good sense would be thinking of doing anything as foolish as getting married again? Well, the answer is simple. This house without a woman would be an empty shell. And pretty dirty, too. It takes a woman all powdered in pink to joyously clean out the drain in the sink. And it takes an angel with long golden lashes and soft resin fingers for dumping the ashes. Yes, it takes a woman, a dainty woman, a sweetheart, a mistress, a wife. Oh, yes, it takes a woman, a fragile woman, to bring you the sweet things in life. That frail young maiden who's constantly there for washing and blueing and shoeing the mare. And it takes a female for setting the table and weaning the Guernsey and cleaning the stable. Yes, it takes a woman, a dainty woman, a sweetheart, a mistress, a wife. Oh, yes, it takes a woman, a fragile woman, to bring you the sweet things in life. And so she'll work until infinity. Three cheers for femininity.
Rah, 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 rah. F-E-M-I-T-Y.
What? Get out of here! And in the winter, she'll shovel the ice and lovingly set out the traps for the mice. She's a joy and treasure, for practically speaking, to whom can you turn when the plumbing is leaking?
To that dainty woman, that fragile woman, that sweetheart, that mistress, that wife. Oh yes, it takes a woman,
a husky woman, to bring you the sweet things in life. Oh yes, it takes a woman, a dainty woman, a sweetheart, a mistress, a wife. It takes a woman, a fragile woman, to bring you the sweet things in life. All right, out of here, all of you.
Congratulations, congratulations, 1,000 congratulations.
Yes, what?
Congratulations, Mr. Vandergelder. All New York is buzzing with the news that you've practically proposed to Irene Malloy. The streets are lined with eligible young ladies prostrate with grief. All of my congratulations and sympathy.
Sympathy?
Oh, did I say that? A slip of the tongue, that's all. No, I'm delighted with the happy news. After all, she was not easy to unload. And by that, I mean, you know what people said, although I, for one, never believed the rumors.
Rumors? No. What rumors?
Oh, nothing to get upset about, Mr. Vandergelder. It's just that her first husband passed on quite naturally. It's just that it happened so sudden. The chatter she made. Well, what can you do? There's no truth in it. No, just one word of advice, Mr. Vandergelder. Eat out.
Mrs. Levi, do you mean to say that Mrs. Malloy...
I mean to say nothing, Mr. Vandergelder. Just keep away from the chowder. Oh, she's ordered her wedding dress. Beautiful. Black. Anyway, as I was saying before, congratulations on your forthcoming nuptials, and may you rest in... I mean, may guardian angels watch over you both, particularly at dinner.
Now look here, Mrs. Levi, you introduced me to Mrs. Malloy, and rumors or not, I intend calling on her again this afternoon, as arranged.
Very well, Mr. Vandergelder, I'll just go back to New York and tell the other girl, the heiress, not to wait.
What did you say?
Nothing. A word. Heiress.
Particulars, Mrs. Levi! I demand particulars! Her name?
Her name... Money! Ernestina Money.
Well, what a lovely, lovely name.
Picture, if you will, hair as shiny as a newly minted dime, eyes as big and round as silver dollars, skin as soft and mossy as an old greenback.
I could feel her now.
Age 19, weight 102, waist 47.
Waist 47?
That's with the money belt.
Oh.
Now, I can arrange for you to meet this Ernestina this very afternoon.
Ain't got the time, Mrs. Levi. I've got to take my niece Ermengarde to New York until she forgets a certain Ambrose Kemper.
I could do that for you, Mr. Vandergelder. I know just how to handle such things.
And then I'm marching in the 14th Street Association Parade.
What an amazing coincidence! Guess who's been chosen to ride on the main float? The spirit of 14th Street, Miss Money. Her mother was a cash, you know.
All right. I'll meet Miss Money at the parade. I intend paying another visit on Mrs. Malloy first.
Very well, Mr. Vandergelder. I'll meet you outside on the bench of Mrs. Malloy's hat shop at 2:30 as usual.
All right. Oh. One more thing, Mrs. Levi. Suppose I decide against Mrs. Malloy, and I don't like Miss Money neither.
Well then, I happen to have one more name on my list, a name I know as well as my own, but we won't get into that now. It'll come up all on its own in good time. Oh, but Horace, wait till you see Ernestina. A vision, a dream.
It takes a woman all powdered in pink to joyously clean out the drain in the sink. And it takes an angel with long golden lashes and soft resin fingers for dumping the ashes.
Yes, it takes a woman. Yes, it takes a woman. You know, Ephraim, I think I'll have that room done over in blue wallpaper. Yes, in blue. Ermengarde, Ambrose, come on out here. We've got plans to make.
Chief clerk, promoted from chief clerk to chief clerk. And if I'm good, in 10 years, I'll be promoted to chief clerk again. Oh, I'm 33 years old, and I still don't get an evening free. When am I gonna live?
Well, you can live on the holidays, Cornelius.
Holidays? Do you remember what happened last Christmas? All those rotten tomato cans exploded, and you and I had to clean up the mess all afternoon. You call that living?
No.
Barnaby? You and I are going to New York.
You mean to close the store?
Uh-huh.
Cornelius, we can't do that.
We'll have to some more rotten tomato cans explode.
Holy cabooses. How do you know?
I'm gonna light a candle under them, that's how I know. It'll make such a smell, customers won't be able to come in here for 24 hours. That'll give us an evening free. We're going to New York, Barnaby. We're gonna live. We're gonna be in danger. We're gonna spend all our money. We're gonna have a good meal. We're gonna get arrested.
Holy cabooses!
And one more thing. We're not coming home until we've each kissed a girl.
Cornelius, you can't do that. Well, you don't know any girls.
I'm 33. Gotta begin sometime.
Well, I'm only 17. It isn't so urgent for me.
New York, Barnaby. Elevated trains. The lights of Broadway. The stuffed whale at Barnum's Museum.
A stuffed whale?
A stuffed whale? What do you say, Barnaby?
Yes, Cornelius, yes!
Now, the first thing we need to do is make you independent. I know. I'll find you a job. Can you dance?
I'm an artist, Mrs. Levi. I paint.
Well then, my card?
Mrs. Dolly Levi, painters taught how to dance.
Now there's a man by the name of Rudolph Reisenweber at the Harmonia Gardens restaurant. You'll go with a note asking if he can have you both entered in the polka competition. The prize is a week's engagement and a solid gold cup. Oh, the cups we won, Ephraim and me.
Hold on, Mrs. Levi. No fiance of mine is stepping foot into a cafe. And I don't mind saying, I'm surprised you have acquaintances in a place like that.
Not acquaintances, Mr. Kemper. Friends. Dear friends from days gone by. My late husband, Ephraim Levi, believed in life in any place you could find it. Cafes, ballrooms, yes, even theaters. Why, every Saturday night, even when times were bad, like clockwork, down the stairs at the Harmonia Gardens restaurant we came. Ephraim and me.
Well, it's all fine and well to come down like clockwork, Mrs. Levi, but you're asking Ermengarde to work
to the restaurant and incidentally mention that Dolly Levi's coming back and she wants a table for two and a chicken for 8 o'clock tonight.
Well, the bottom rows are right, Cornelius. Now, hold the candle in ones on the top row, but not too close. They look like they're ready to bust. Holy cabooses! I can smell from up here!
Come on, Barnaby, we're going to New York! Out there, there's a world outside of Yonkers. Way out there beyond this hick town, Barnaby. There's a slick town, Barnaby. Out there, full of shine and full of sparkle. Close your eyes and see it glisten, Barnaby. Listen, Barnaby. Put on any clothes, there's a world out there. Dime cigars.
We're gonna find adventure in the evening air. Girls in white, nay, perfume night. The lights are bright as the stars. Put on your Sunday clothes. We're gonna ride through town in one of those new horse-drawn open cars. We'll see the shows at Delmonico's, and we'll close the town in a whirl. And we won't come home until we've kissed a girl.
Put on your Sunday clothes when you feel down and out. Strut down the street and have your picture took. Just like a dream, your spirits seem to turn about.
That sign is a certain sign that you feel as fine as you look.
Beneath your parasol, the world is all a smile. That makes you feel brand new down to your toes. Get out your feathers, your pads and leathers, your beads and buckles and balls. For there's no blue Monday in your Sunday clothes.
Come on, Barnaby, we're going to New York. Elevated trains, the lights of Broadway.
Holy caboose!
The stuffed whale at Barnum's Museum.
Wow!
Come on!
Put on your Sunday clothes when you feel down and out. Shut down the street and have your picture told. Just like a dream, your spirit seemed to turn about. That Sunday shine is a certain sign that you feel as fine as you look. Beneath your parasol, the world is all a smile. That makes you feel brand new.
Today. Sure, it would look very nice with a green feather. Everyone. Oh, you know what? You should get a hat to cover that up. Here you go. Hello, everyone. Good morning. How are you? Oh, it's a beautiful day, isn't it? The sun is shining. The birds are... Oh, I've been off feathers and cherries for all of my friends. Oh, with your generous proportions of a head, you would need a special order of a hat. Good morning. Oh, my. It's almost 10 o'clock. I'm going to be late. Oh, dear. Oh dear, oh my, would you look at that? 10 o'clock and the shop not opened yet. It's all because of this impending marriage, I tell you. What marriage? Oh, I thought you knew. Why, the impending marriage Mrs. Levi's arranging between Mr. Horace Van de Gelder, the well-known Yonkers half-a-millionaire, and my employer and friend, Miss Irene Malloy. Although, if you ask me, he'll never take the place of her late husband, Mr. Peter Malloy. May he rest in peace wherever he is, I'm not sure. He was a caution, you know. Oh, it's all too much, but with late husbands and new marriages, and on top of everything else, Miss Mortimer returning her hat for the third time. Same old story. She wants more cherries and feathers, to catch a beau, I suppose. Although, if you ask me, she'd do better with a nice, heavy veil. I told her, ribbons down her back is what we'll be wearing this summer. Catch a gentleman's eye. But she'd have none of it. Cherries and feathers. And on today of all days when that poor dear sweet Mrs. Malloy has enough on her mind, what with...
With what, Minnie?
With the door. It's stuck.
It's stuck, then pull.
And as I was saying, Mrs. Malloy, I could bite my tongue for the things I've said and the things I'm going to say. But as long as I've gotten this far, I might as well go all the way. Mrs. Malloy, why? Why?
Say it, Minnie. Why have I decided to marry Mr. Horace Van de Gelder?
Oh, Mrs. Malloy, I didn't ask you that. I'd rather die on the rack than ask such a personal question. But as long as you did bring it up.
I'm marrying Horace Van de Gelder for one reason and one reason alone, Minnie. To break away from the millinery business. I hate hats.
Oh, Mrs. Malloy.
And I can no longer stand being suspected of being a wicked woman with nothing to show for it.
Mrs. Malloy.
Don't protest, Minnie. All milliners are suspected of being wicked women. That's why I can't go into restaurants or balls or theaters. That's all the proof they'd need. Now just take my word for it, Minnie. Either I marry Horace Van de Gelder or I break out of this place like a fire engine. Oh, no, not Miss Mortimer again.
Miss Mortimer. I'll take care of it.
No, Minnie. Leave it be. You can make another hat for Miss Mortimer if you'd like. I'm wearing this one myself.
Oh, but you can't. You're a widow. And that hat, well, it's provocative, that's what.
Is it, Minnie? Well, who knows who may walk into the shop today? And provocative may be just what I want to be.
Oh, Mrs. Malloy!
I'll be wearing ribbons down my back this summer, blue and green and streaming in the yellow sky. So if someone special comes my way this summer, he might notice me passing by. And so I'll try to make it easier to find me in the stillness of July, because a breeze might stir a rainbow up behind me. That might happen to catch a gentleman's eye. and he might smile and take me by the hand this summer, making me recall how lovely love can be.
Horses couldn't make me ask this next question I'm about to ask, but I'm going to ask it anyhow. Do you love Horace Van de Gelder?
No, Minnie, I don't. Peter Malloy, God rest him, was my share of love, and I'm not saying I was shortchanged. Once is enough for a woman as long as it's true love, and it was that. Minnie, look, there's two monster men! Miss Morse! Oh, I'll take...
Oh, Mrs. Malloy, you that... Love.
Love enough. It's a bit of adventure I could do with now. We'll get them all heated up and we'll drop them cold. It'll be good practice for married life. Now you go back into the workroom. I know some ways you can park up our appearances. Besides, a bit of a wait will only make them nervous and easier for us to...
If you say vampire, I'll scream.
Vampire! And so... I'll try to make it easier to find me in the stillness of July, because a breeze might stir a rainbow up behind me that might happen to catch a gentleman's eye. We'll get an adventure out of this.
Okay. We'll get an adventure out of this yet, Barnaby. All day long, we wander around New York. Nothing happens. And then we come to the quietest street in the city and...
Van der Gelder!
Oh, is he still out there?
He's sitting right on that bench. Cornelius, are you sure this is an adventure?
You don't have to ask, Barnaby. When you're in one, you'll know it, all right? How much money do we have left?
Oh, not much. 40 cents for dinner, and 30 cents for the train back, and then 20 cents to see the whale. 90 cents, why?
Okay. When those women come out, we'll have to pretend to be... Customers, that's it. Maybe the best thing to do is make them think we're rich. Then we won't have to pay for it about town looking for hats for
Loy.
Here, Cornelius Hackle.
Here, Barnaby Tucker.
My pleasure, gentlemen. Now, what can I do for you two?
More hats, you see, and we wanted to buy a lady or two to
Loy. No. You see, we're two ladies about town looking for hats to Malloy, and we want a hat! For a lady, of course, and everybody said to go to Mrs. Malloy, because she's so pretty. I mean, her hats are so pretty.
Oh, and so reasonable, too. As reasonable as under a dollar would still leave us not to see that whale.
You'll have to excuse him, Mrs. Malloy. He's come all this way from Yonkers to see a stuffed whale, and he's all excited. Keep an eye on the street, Barnaby. Maybe you'll see it pass by.
Is it big and black with mean little red eyes?
Yes.
Well, it's right on that bench.
Excuse me, but did you say Yonkers, Mr. Hackle?
Oh. Yonkers, and pardon me for saying this, you should see Yonkers. Mr. Malloy would like to see Yonkers with you?
Oh, I'm a widow, Mr. Hackle.
You are?
Barnaby, she's a widow! Oh, that's too bad. I'm sure Mr. Malloy would have loved to see Yonkers, especially in this hat. I mean, on you, of course, not on him. May you rest in peace. You're Catholic, aren't you? Well, don't let that scare you. I'd be willing to change if we ever... Mrs. Malloy! If you should ever have a Sunday free in the near future, well, I'd be more than willing to show you Yonkers from top to bottom.
Well, I may be there sooner than you think.
Oh, really?
You see, I have a friend who lives in Yonkers.
Do you?
And perhaps you know him, although it's usually so foolish to ask in cases like that. It's a Mr. Vandergelder.
Horace? Vandergelder?
A Vandergelder's hay and feed?
Do you know him?
No.
Well, Mr. Vandergelder is a substantial man and well-liked, they tell me.
A lovely man, Mrs. Malloy, just has one fault. Well, he's hard as nails.
Cornelius? Oh. Cornelius, I think he's...
Now, perhaps your friend might like this one.
Wow, that's a lovely hat.
Look out! Help us, Mrs. Malloy. We'll explain everything
later. Gentlemen, what are you doing? Mr. Hackle, Mr. Tucker, I insist you both come out of here this instant or I'll be forced to. Come on out of here right now, please. Mr. Vandergelder.
Mrs. Malloy, I don't suppose Mrs. Levi is in here, is she? She was supposed to meet me on that bench a half an hour ago. You know, when I make appointments, I expect people to be on time. Oh, here. I bought you a present. Chocolate-covered peanuts, unshelled. That's the expensive kind. Did I just see you in here speaking with two men?
Men? What would men be doing in a lady's hat shop? Now, why don't we go back into my workroom? I'm so anxious for you to see it.
I saw it last week.
So you did. Well, Mr. Vandergelder, what's new in the hay and feed business? I hear you have three friends, all hard as nails.
What on earth are you talking about?
Yonkers. I hear it's a very beautiful city.
And who has been telling you about Yonkers, may I ask?
Nobody, a friend.
What friend?
You see, he...
He?
A customer, Mr. Vandergelder, someone quite well-to-do, as a matter of fact. And he was in here buying hats for ladies. In fact, you might even know him. Usually so f***ing in cases like that. It's, Mr. Cornelius Hackle.
I'm sorry, did you just say Hackle?
Why, yes.
Well, he happens to be my head clerk, that's all. Mrs. Malloy, I demand an explanation!
And I'm... going to give it to you. Why shouldn't she know Cornelius Hackle? Everyone in New York knows Cornelius Hackle. He's in all the fashionable homes, at the opera. Why, he's at the Harmonia Gardens restaurant at least three times a week.
Impossible. He's only got $146.35, and I keep it in my own safe.
Oh, Mr. Vandergelder, you're killing me. He's one of the Hackles. They built the, canal.
What canal?
The Panama. Erie. Both.
It ain't the...
And pulled Jenny Lind through the streets?
Who?
Cornelius Hackle. And who dressed up as a waiter at the Fifth Avenue Hotel and dropped an oyster down Mrs. Astor's? Oh, I can't say it. But it was Cornelius Hackle. He's the playboy of New York. Now, Irene, don't deny it. I can see you were taken with him just like everybody else.
Dolly, what are you saying? I've only seen him once in my life. Really, Dolly, I...
Excuse me.
Of course.
Minnie, hold your tongue!
There's a man in there!
Now, look here. If there's a man in
that
closet...
No, Mr. Vandergelder! You can't. It's too dangerous.
Stand aside, Mrs. Levi. No man that hides in ladies' closets can frighten me.
No man indeed, Mr. Vandergelder. I mean, I can see your muscles rippling back and forth under your coat. Ripple, ripple, ripple.
Mrs. Levi, I insist that you stand aside.
Stand! And indeed, Mr. Vandergelder, that's exactly what the courts will want to know when you're accused of entering that closet without a search warrant. I mean, what do you stand for if you don't stand for the law of this great land? I know what I stand for. I stand for motherhood, America, and a hot lunch for orphans.
Orphans!
Take off your hat, sir. Betsy Ross's flag is passing. Do you see him on the hill at Gettysburg? Neath that great triumphal arch. If you see him as he's trampling through the grapes of wrath, stand up and march, march, march.
Not affected you, sir. I came here as an immigrant girl at 14 years of age from a land that oppressed my people, and I must now echo here what was said by that great and patriotic American,
Moses.
Stand for motherhood, and a hot lunch for orphans. Take off your hat, sir. Betsy Ross's flag is passing. Do you see him on the bridge at Waterloo? Need that great triumphal arch. If you hear him singing Dixie and the Sugar Cane, stand up and march, march, march.
I stand for motherhood, America, and a hot lunch for orphans.
I regret that I would like to give for my country.
Do you see him on the hill at Gettysburg?
I see, yes,
that great triumphal arch.
Stonewall Jackson,
if you see him tramping through the grapes of wrath, stand up and march, march.
4 score and 7 years ago.
March, march, march.
To form a more perfect union.
March, march.
Damn the torpedoes, full speed ahead.
March, march, march.
So you see, Mr. Vandergelder, there couldn't possibly be a man in this closet. God bless you.
Mrs. Malloy.
Yes, Mr. Vandergelder, there is a man in that closet. And another under that table.
What the devil?
And there also happens to be a very simple explanation. But for the present, good afternoon.
Oh, good Lord, the whole room's crawling with men. I'll never get over it. I take it I'll see you later this afternoon, Mr. Vandergelder.
You certainly will, with a certain young lady on the main float at the end of the parade. Good day, Mrs. Malloy.
Mrs. Malloy, we can explain everything.
Mr. Hackle, I do not wish to hear any explanations. Just you and Mr. Tucker do the pleasure of leaving my shop at once, or I call for Officer Gogarty.
No.
Well, Irene, if you ask me, calling an officer is letting them off too easy. The law courts, that's where they belong. Now, I've been adding up the offenses these two have committed in the past few minutes, and believe me, you've got grounds for at least 2 writs, a non-compos mentis, and a garnishee. Now, the most important thing to do is try to show that you've settled things amicably first. Have dinner with them.
Dinner?
Is that absolutely necessary, Dolly?
It's the way things are done in the law, Irene. Dinner first, garnishee afterwards.
Well, if it must be, Mr. Hackle, Mr. Tucker, you may take myself and Miss Fay to dinner.
Delighted, Mrs. Malloy. I speak for Barnaby, too. Now, I hear there is a lovely restaurant in the railroad train station.
Oh, no, Mr. Hackle, if the Harmonia Gardens is good enough for you and your substantial friends, it's good enough for us. Besides, I hear they have a lovely orchestra there, Minnie.
We couldn't go there, Mrs. Malloy. Now, don't get me wrong, it's not the money or anything. It's the whale! It's the whale! It's not the whale, Barnaby, it's the dancing. They have dancing at places like that, contests, and I don't know how. It would take me weeks, months, years to learn, even if I had the... What's this? Mrs. Dolly Levi, 33-year-old chief clerk's taught to dance.
Now, it's very simple, Mr. Hackle. You put one arm here and one arm here.
It's no use. I have absolutely no sense of rhythm.
Absolutely no sense of rhythm is one of the primary requirements for learning by the Gallagher-Levi method. We'll start with the waltz cake turn. It goes like this. Stop it. Right foot touch, left foot touch, back and forward, around, release, unfurl. That's lovely. When I think of the women that'll find heaven in your arms. Let's get back to lesson one. Put your hand on her waist and stand. With her right in your left hand. And 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3.
Look, I'm dancing.
Of course you are, Mr. Hackle. Take the someone whose arms you're in. Hold on to 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3.
Wow, I'm dancing.
Turn around and turn around, try floating through the air. Can't you be a little more aesthetic?
Don't you think my dancing has a polish and a flair?
The word I think I'd use is athletic.
Well, my heart is about to burst. My head is about to pop. And now that I'm dancing, who cares if I ever stop?
You're next, Mr. Tucker. Glide and step and then step and glide.
And everyone, stand aside!
Wow, he's dancing!
To polka if you worked a week or so, or the tango filled with passion seething.
I might join the chorus of the Castle Garden show.
Well, whatever you do, for God's sakes, keep breathing.
For my heart is about to burst. My head is about to pop. And now that we're dancing, who cares if we ever stop?
Come on, Barnaby.
Make the music weave a spell
as around and around you go, your spirits will hit the top.
And now that we're dancing, who cares if we ever stop?
2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2.
And now that we're dancing, who cares if we ever stop?
How are you, Miss Levi?
How are you, Mrs. Rose?
Same. Aches in my back, pains in my side, stabs in my liver. I'm fine. You know, my daughter Fanny got married.
Oh, did she?
A year ago, last September. It's been a long time since you lived here, Miss Levi. A long, long time.
Ephraim, let me go. It's been long enough, Ephraim. Every evening for all these years, I let out the cat, I lock the door, I make myself a little rum toddy, and before I go to bed, I say a prayer thanking God that I'm independent and that no one's life was mixed up with mine. Then, one night an oak leaf fell out of my Bible. I placed it there when you asked me to marry you, Ephraim. A perfectly good leaf, but without color and without life. And suddenly I realized that I was like that leaf. For years I had not shed one tear, nor had I been filled with the wonderful hope that something would turn out well. And so I've decided to rejoin the human race. And Ephraim, I want you to give me away. Before the parade passes by, I'm gonna get in step while there's still time left. Before the parade passes by.
Dolly, Cornelius is taking us down to the 14th Street Parade and everybody will be marching. Come with us, Dolly.
But Irene, you're crying.
Oh, Dolly, the world is full of wonderful things. Come with us, Dolly.
I will, Irene. I will. Before the parade passes by, I'm gonna go and taste Saturday's high life. Before the parade passes by, I'm gonna get some life back into my life. I'm ready to move out in. I've had enough of passing by life. With the rest of them, with the best of them, I can hold my head up high. For I've got a goal again, I've got a drive again. I'm gonna feel my heart coming alive again before the parade passes by. Look at that crowd up ahead. Listen and hear that brass harmony growing. Look at that crowd up ahead. Pardon me if my old spirit is showing. All of those lights over there seem to be telling me where I'm going. When the whistles blow and the cymbals crash and the sparklers light the sky, I'm gonna raise the roof, I'm gonna carry on. Give me an old trombone, give me an old baton. Before the parade passes by.
Passes by. Listen and hear that brass harmony blowing. Where the parade.
Miss Money!
Miss Money, what have they done to you? Mrs. Levi! What is the meaning of this?
Nothing to get upset about, Mr. Vandergelder. Just a last-minute substitution. Miss Money had an emergency meeting at the Mint and couldn't make it, but don't worry, she'll be there tonight. By the way, I might be a little bit late, so you'll meet Miss Money on your own. She's in a beautiful dress, very colorful, and she'll be singing a classic tune. Yes, Sweet Rosie O'Grady. You couldn't miss her if you tried.
All right, Mrs. Levi. I'll be there. But only because I already paid for the arrangement. Understand this? From this moment on, you are hereby... Is that clear? From this moment on, you are now just a woman like anyone else.
Ephraim, he's as good as mine. I'm gonna raise the roof, I'm gonna carry on. Give me an old trombone, give me an old baton before the parade passes by.
Thank you.
it's been so lovely looking at the lights of 14th Street these past 4 hours. But now, perhaps we better call for a hack or we won't make it to the Harmonia Gardens on time. Oh, there's one. Yoo-hoo!
No, Mrs. Malloy, we can't do that. Now, don't get me wrong. It's not the money or anything. It's that really elegant people never take hacks.
Hacks is out.
They all go by streetcar.
J.P. Vanderbilt, Diamond Jim Morgan.
Then by all means, a streetcar.
Imagine, I've been elegant all my life and I never even knew it.
Of course, if you'd really like to be elegant.
We do!
You walk.
Yes, New York.
In New York, it's really us, Barnaby and Cornelius.
All the guests of Mr. Hackle are feeling great and look spectacular. What a knack there is to that, acting like a born aristocrat. We've got elegance. If you ain't got elegance, you can never ever carry it off.
All who are well-bred agree Minnie Faye has pedigree.
Exercise your wildest whims tonight. We are out with Diamond Jims tonight.
Could they be misleading us?
Silver spoons were used for feeding us. We've got elegance. If you ain't got elegance,
you can never ever carry it off. Middle class, don't speak of it, savoir faire, we reek of it.
Some were born with rags and patches, but
we use dollar bills for matches, and
Vanderbilt kowtows to us.
J.P. Morgan scrapes and bows to us. We've got elegance,
we were born with elegance.
Have you noticed when I hold my cup, the saucer never moves?
Way I keep my pinky up, indubitably proves that
we've got elegance. We got built in elegance, and with
elegance,
we'll carry it
off. Got elegance. If you ain't got elegance, you can never ever carry it off. We've got elegance. We've got elegance.
Minnie, look, they're counting their money again. Isn't that just like the rich? Well, gentlemen, aren't you going to escort us in?
Oh, yes, Mrs. Malloy. Barnaby.
I like whales, too.
Mrs. Malloy.
Yes, Mr. Hackle?
As we make our way inside.
Yes, Mr. Hackle?
May I put my hand around your waist?
Yes, Mr. Hackle, but I might as well warn you, a corset is a corset.
You heard what Mrs. Levi said. We gotta show your uncle we mean business. Now, come on. Come on. Can you cry a little faster? You're throwing me off step.
Wow, 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 wow. So
Sweet friend! Wait, where are you going? The restaurant is this way! Come back! Sweet Rosie O'Grady! My sweet little Ruth!
And it is my order as head waiter of the Harmonia Gardens and your supreme commander that tonight of all nights, our usual lightning service will be twice as lightning as ever, or else. I trust you are finding this table satisfactory, sir. The private dining rooms cost a bit more, but they do afford the best view of the entertainment.
$1.40. That's all that's left.
Are you sure? Go check again.
Prepare yourself for a big night, Minnie. We're out with two of New York's best known sports.
I did make a mistake. There's only $1.35 left. I'll count again.
No, don't. I can't afford it.
I'm going to order everything on the menu, waiter!
Before, sir, you will have to move. This table is reserved for Mrs. Levi and party.
And who do you think I am? Only it's Horace Van de Gelder and party. She's in my party, I ain't in hers.
Oh, Mr. Van de Gelder, of course. It's just that Mrs. Levi never mentioned anything about you bringing your...
My personal physician! That's enough rouge, doctor.
But Mrs. Levi only ordered chicken for two.
Yes, chicken. Chickens are dear.
And pâté maison, soup du jour, and pommes soufflées.
What?
Why didn't you tell me this was an Oriental establishment? We'll take two bowls of rice. Now get out. Now, Miss Money, I understand you carry your respectable sums under your belt.
Yep. $2. Only it's in my garter.
About our reputations, Cornelius, but Minnie and I don't care who see us tonight. Well, Minnie, what have you decided?
Oh, I couldn't have anything at these prices. No, I really couldn't.
Eight grindstones, what a sensible girl. Waiter, we'll have four beers, a loaf of yesterday's bread, and some cheese.
Yesterday's bread? Oh, Cornelius, now I know how you keep half of New York in stitches all the time. Minnie, have you ever tried pheasant?
Pheasant?
It's not that. It's like chill.
Well, why? I'll loan you this. Now let's order something until that rice comes. Waitress, can we have a roast suckling pig, some of that oyster stuffing, some cheese fondue, oh, and some lady fingers. Now, what will you have? with those big ears. What are you doing after the show?
It's sweet of you to worry about our digestion, Cornelius, but I'm sure the pheasants are fresh. We'll take four, please, and a nice red wine.
Wait a minute. No wine.
No wine?
Champagne!
Champagne!
Oh, it's once in a lifetime, Barnaby, champagne, Neapolitan ice cream, and hothouse peaches. And give this to the band leader and tell him to play to a wild rose. We want music while we dine.
Say, what? Why is, isn't this a cafe? And let's go!
The Vandergelders are not...
all right. I'll dance myself. Here, give $2 to the band leader, would ya? Tell him play something refined. I'm gonna do the hoochie coochie!
Right, I'll send for the band. I promise you won't order anything else.
You wait here, Miss Money. I'll tell them to play a waltz. My purse!
My wallet!
Oh, Miss Money!
Two more pheasants!
Cornelius!
Hey, you! That's my purse!
Excuse me, what? That's my wallet! I know it's mine, there's nothing in it, but $1, 3 dimes, 5 pennies, and a... Cornelius? Did he say 2 pheasants? 3 pheasants to the house! Never mind if I don't see that whale, I'll buy one of my own!
What is this? Shouting? How many times have I told you not to shout, young lady? This is our money garden.
But not- sir, she's here. The lady.
What? Are you sure?
Oh, it's just like you told me, sir. 8 o'clock on the nose, up pulls a carriage with a tall lady with red hair and the biggest handbag I ever saw.
It is. It's Dolly. She's back.
Rudolph! Is it true? I heard somebody laughing outside the kitchen window, and it sounded like it was...
It is. It's Dolly. Fritz, tell the band. She just stepped out of her carriage.
Oh, Rudolph, it's like old times again. Sir! Sir! Rudy! She's here.
Thank you.
doing in that getup? And you're a half an hour late? And I demand an explanation of...
Ernestina.
Exactly.
Ernestina, whom I trusted.
You wanted to do the hoochie-coochie.
Well, Horace, she always was artistic. Now, I want our table moved down front. There's a dancer in the competition I particularly want you to see. I'm starving. I can't eat a thing. What have you ordered?
What you wanted? A chicken.
Oh, did you say a chicken? Oh, I don't think I could face a chicken. Not a chicken. Not after what's happened.
Good, then cancel the chicken.
And bring a turkey.
What are you doing now?
Oh, nothing. Just looking the place over, getting acquainted with my surroundings.
Well, that's the trouble with you, Dolly. Always sticking your nose in everybody else's business, wanting to know what's going on all the time. Anybody who married you would be as nervous as a cat.
What? What's that you're saying?
Is that anybody who married you would be as nervous as a cat?
Horace Vandergelder, you get that idea out of your head this minute. Understand once and for all, I have no intention of marrying you.
Oh, I didn't mean that.
Well, I certainly do hope not. Horace Vandergelder, you go your way and I'll go mine. I'm not some Irene Malloy whose head can be turned by a few chocolate-covered peanuts.
Unshelled.
Unshelled. Why, the idea of you even mentioning such a thing...
Mrs. Levi, you misunderstood me.
Well, I certainly do hope not, but understand, if I had any intention of marrying again, it would be to a far more pleasure-loving man than you. Oh, here's the waiter with our food. Thank you. I'll serve Mr. Vandergelder. Oh, look at that. It looks like some white meat and some dumplings, lighter than air they are, and some giblets, very tender and very good for you. Start right in on the wine at once. I think you'll feel better. However, since you brought the matter up, there's one more thing I'm going to say.
I didn't bring the matter up at all.
One more thing I ought to say before we forget all about it. It's true. I'm a woman who likes to manage things, a woman who likes to know what's going on. But I wouldn't like to know what's going on inside of your household. You'll have to do that yourself, God helping you.
There's nothing wrong with my household.
Very well. Let's not say another word about it. Have some beets, Horace. They're good.
I don't like beets.
That's good. No, Horace, a complaining, quarrelsome, friendless soul like you is no sort of companion for me. You salt your beets, and I'll salt mine.
Would you stop saying that?
I won't say another word.
Good!
Except this. At your age, Horace, you should enjoy hearing the honest truth.
My age. You're always talking about my age.
Well, I don't know what your age is, but I know that up in Yonkers, with bad food and bad temper, you'll double it in 6 months. Now have some beets, Horace. They're good.
I don't like beets. I hate beets.
That's nice. No, the pity of it is you could be a perfectly charming, witty, amiable man if you wanted to.
I don't want to be charming!
But look at you! You are! You can't hide it! Now sit down, Horace, and let's talk of something else. But there is one more thing I'm going to say.
I don't want to hear it! And you're wasting your time, Dolly Levi. I won't ask you to marry me.
Oh, well, I suppose that means you want me to ask you? Well, I'm sorry, Horace. I'm turning you down.
How can you turn me down when I haven't asked you anything?
It's no use arguing. Just sit down. Let me cut your wings.
I've got a headache. I'm going home.
You can't go now. The competition's about to begin.
Here's the money to pay for dinner. Here's $20. Wait a minute. There's nothing in here but a dollar, three dimes, five pennies, and a button. This isn't my purse. I've lost my purse.
Barnaby, that wallet you found.
Impossible. I can't imagine you without your purse.
It's Vandergelder's. We've got to get out of here.
What am I going to do? I've never been here before. They don't know me. Stop eating that turkey. I can't pay for it.
Horace, it's the latest thing, a polka. And I want our table moved over there so we can get a better view of this dancer's graceful movements.
Wait a minute. That man! That dancer!
Oh, isn't he wonderful? With talent like that, he's sure to win the solid gold cup.
Mrs. Malloy, it's been a lovely evening, but I think it's time to cut it a bit short.
Stop, Lantan!
But Vandergelder's right over there. We've got to get out of here.
We'll go, but we'll dance our way out. Oh.
Cornelius Huckle!
Mr. Vandekelder!
Barnaby Tucker!
Mr. Vandergelder!
Ermengarde! Dolly Levi, this is your doing! What are you up to?
Mr. Vandekelder, I can explain everything.
I don't want to hear your explanations! You're f-
off fire!
Arrest that man!
Alright, you're all under arrest. Arrest them all! All
hey,
of you!
What? Barnaby? Why is he fired?
No,
that's better. Now, you're all charged with inciting to riot, disturbing the peace, and assaulted battery, and several other equally serious violations of the law of this city. Now, is there anyone here to speak on your behalf? I say, is there anyone here to speak on your behalf? Mrs. Dolly Levi, counselor at law.
Your Honor, the defense rests.
What?
No, what? There's no need to call witnesses, ladies and gentlemen. When I look upon this bench, I see a prow that gleams with honor. A pair of snow-white whiskers that bristle with fair play. And a nose. I ask you to look at that nose, ladies and gentlemen. A nose that shines in the night. Beacon. Could you turn this way a bit, Your Honor, so we can get a better look at your beacon?
Ooh. That's a nice beacon.
A living symbol of the motto of this great land. E probuscus unum. Your Honor, I ask for freedom for my clients and a verdict of guilty for the only real culprit here, Horace Vandergelder of Yonkers, New York.
Dolly?
The one man responsible for these grievous charges of willful destruction of private property.
A curtain torn, a waitress bruised, and a solid gold cup bent.
Cruelty to a poor, unfortunate minor. Would you mind repeating that, dear?
Mrs. Levi, if it pleases the court, I have something to say.
Go right ahead, Mr. Hackle. I was just about to call you.
Cornelius Hackle! If you dare testify against me, you'll be discharged.
You've already done that, Mr. Vandergelder.
I'll do it again.
You've done it again. Then even if you hadn't, I'd still say what I have to say, Your Honor. I don't know much about disturbing the peace or inciting the riot, but what I do know is that what happened to me today is the greatest thing that could happen to a man. It might never have happened if I obeyed your orders and stayed in Yonkers, New York. Your Honor, well, I'm talking none other than love.
What? Are you trying to tell me that after 33 years you've fallen in love because you take a single evening off?
Oh, Mr. Vandergelder, I didn't fall in love with Miss Irene Malloy of this city in just an evening. It was much quicker than that. An hour. Yeah, even that's too long. What's less than a minute?
A second.
No, less than that.
A moment.
That's it. I'll go slowly so you can get this all down. Your eyes.
heart knows, in a moment, you will never be alone again. I held her for an instant, but my arms felt sure and strong. It only takes a moment to be loved a whole life long.
Isn't the world full of wonderful things? There I sat cooped up in Yonkers for years and years, and wonderful people like Mrs. Malloy were walking around, and I didn't know it at all. Well, I don't know if you can see it from where you're sitting, but the way her eyes and cheek and forehead all meet. I tell you, a beautiful woman is the greatest gift of God on earth. Oh, you can talk all you'd like about the pyramids and Niagara Falls, but that isn't it at all. Well, of course, I've seen a woman before, but today I talked to one equal to equal. And they are so much different from men. Well, I bet you could know a woman for 100 years and not know if she liked you or not. I've lost so many things today. My job, my future, everything that people think is important. But I don't care. Because even if I have to dig ditches the rest of my life, I'll be a ditch digger who once had a wonderful day.
Mr. Hackle, I missed a few words back there.
Of course.
Right after... it only
takes a moment, but his arms felt sure and strong. It only takes a moment.
He held me instant, but his arms felt safe and strong. It only takes a moment to be loved a whole life long.
And that is all that love's about,
and we'll recall when time runs out.
Dismissed, dismissed, all dismissed. All except Horace Vandegelder of Yonkers, New York. You're free, my children. Go, go, and God bless you.
Well, Horace, there's your life. Without niece, without clerks, without bride, and without your purse. It looks like there's only one thing left to say.
If it's to ask me to marry you, Dolly Levi, never. Not in a million years would I ever marry you.
That wasn't it at all, Horace. What I was going to say to you was... goodbye!
What?
Goodbye.
Now hold on, Dolly.
No, Horace, I failed, and when a woman fails, there's nothing else she can say but
Goodbye. Goodbye. Goodbye, goodbye, goodbye. Goodbye. Don't try to stop me, Horace, please. Wave your little hand and whisper so long, dearie. You ain't gonna see me anymore. But when you discover that your life is dreary, don't you come a-knocking at my door. For I'll be all dolled up and singing that song that says, you dog, I told you so. So wave your little hand and whisper so long, dearie, dearie, should have said so long ago. For you treated me so rotten and rough, I've had enough of feeling low. So wave your little hand and whisper so long, dearie, dearie, should have said so long ago. For I can hear that choo-choo calling me on to a fancy new address. Yeah, I can hear that choo-choo calling me on to that happiness express. I'm gonna learn to dance and drink and smoke a cigarette. I'm gone as far away from Yonkers as a girl can get. And on those cold winter nights, Horace, you can snuggle up to your cash register. It's a little lumpy, but it rings. Don't come a-knocking, I'll be all dolled up and singing that song that says, you dog, I told you so. So, Horace, you will find your life a sad old story when you see your Dolly shuffle off to glory. Oh, you should have said so long. So long ago.
I wouldn't marry you, Dolly Levi, if you were the last woman on Earth. Not if you asked me a million times. I certainly don't need you now. Hey, and I'll go. Oh, Dolly, Dolly, Dolly!
Mr. Vandegelder.
What? Oh. Too, is it Mr. Heckle? Come crawling back, have you?
Oh, no, Mr. Vandegelder. I just came back to put a lid on the sheep dip and to collect my $146.35. You see, I'm going into my own business, and since the only thing I know is hay and feed, I'm opening my own store.
And Cornelius has found the perfect location, right across the street from you.
So you think you can compete with Vandergelders, do you? Well, just you try. Aha! Going back, eh? What do you want?
My back salary for the past 4 months. $6.12.
You can't do this to me. Any of you. I'll go to the courts. I'll get lawyers. I'll...
Why, Horace Vandergelder, as I live and breathe, if you aren't handsome in that outfit. So few men nowadays have the courage to wear black bow ties and taupe.
Dolly Gallagher.
Now, I know what you're going to say. You're not satisfied with Ernestina, but I found you another girl, the ideal wife. But don't let me interrupt you. You were doing something. What were you doing?
Getting Cornelius's money, Dolly. $146.
And 35 cents.
Plus my 6 cents.
And the money my mama left me. $52.48.
38 cents.
48 cents.
38 cents! All right. If it's the money you want, it's in my safe upstairs. Well, you go wait in that side room over there. I'll be back.
Money, 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 money. Mr. Vandergelder's money. It's like the sun we walk under. It can kill or cure. Vandergelder's never tired of saying that most people in the world are fools. And in a way, he's right, isn't he? Himself, Cornelius, Irene, myself. Yeah, we're all fools, and we're all in danger of destroying the world in our folly. But the surest way to keep us out of harm is to give us the 4 or 5 simple human pleasures that are right in the world. And that takes a little money. Now, the difference between a little money and no money at all is enormous, and that can shatter the world. And the difference between an enormous amount of money and no money at all is very slight. And that can shatter the world, too. You see, my husband, Ephraim Levi, always used to say money, pardon the expression, is like manure. It's not worth a thing unless it's spread around encouraging young things to grow. Anyhow, that's the opinion of the second Mrs. Vandergelder, which reminds me, Ephraim, I'm ready for that sign.
Well, don't just stand there, you idiot. That goes upstairs.
Oh, Horace, as I was saying before, I found you the ideal wife.
Dolly Gallagher! I don't want you to find me no more ideal wives. If I want an ideal wife, I'll find one of my own. And I've found her! And it's you, damn it!
Why, Horace?
I know I've been an idiot about Mrs. Malloy and that other woman, but Dolly, forgive me and marry me.
Stop right there!
Okay.
You know as well as I do that you're the first citizen of Yonkers, and as your wife, I would have to be a somebody. Answer me, Horace. Am I a somebody?
You are. Wonderful woman.
No, Horace, it's not enough. It's not enough to load your wife with money and jewels and insist she be a benefactress to half the town. Which reminds me, it's bad business letting Cornelius open up a shop right across the street from you. Better take him back and let him be your partner.
Partner?
And Barnaby can have Cornelius's old job.
Now, hold on,
Dolly. That way we can all dance together at Ermengarde's wedding.
Oh, that does it? You've gone too far this time. I'll dance at no weddings. Besides, I don't know how. It would take me weeks, months, years to learn it. All right, I'll dance.
Horace, I never thought I'd hear you say a thing like that.
Hey, no. That front room, you idiot.
Horace Vandergelder, what's going on up there?
Oh, nothing. I just thought I'd have this front room done over in blue wallpaper.
Horace?
Well, I know the old paper ain't worn out yet, but that fella's just set up shop and needs a good start. See, Dolly, the way I see it, money, pardon the expression, is like manure. It's not worth a thing unless it's...
Thank you, Ephraim.
Hello, Dolly. Well, hello, Dolly. It's so nice to have you here where you belong. I never knew Dolly without you. Dolly, life was awfully hard, and more than that, awfully wrong.
My hat, Horace, I'm staying where I'm at. Horace, Dolly, you'll never go away.
Wonderful woman.
Again.
Hello. Thank you.